This video is sponsored by Audible. Listen to a free audiobook and two Audible originals with a link in the description. Singapore is not known for its subtlety. From the minute you land and see the world's tallest indoor waterfall inside the airport, you're inundated with beautiful, clean, and green architecture. The sight of extraordinary, lush buildings is so common that it almost becomes boring. All the rest, though, pale in comparison to one. What the Eiffel Tower is to Paris, or the Opera House to Sydney, the Marina Bay Sands is to Singapore. You just can't visit without taking a photo. In this one small resort area is the famous Gardens by the Bay, Flower Dome, Cloud Forest, Outdoor Event Piazza, Convention Center, Theater, Art and Science Museum, Luxury Mall, two floating crystal pavilions, and finally, three-tower, 55-story hotel, with the world's highest pool on top. Altogether, the Marina Bay Sands Resort cost $5.5 billion, making it the fifth most expensive building in the world. Perhaps the only subtle thing about it is, oddly enough, also the reason it was built, the casino. Singapore has long been a popular destination for tourism. Beyond its use of English, far more than its closest competitor, Hong Kong, it's also well known for its beauty, lack of crime, and cleanliness. As an aviation hub with one of the world's best airlines, it's also cheap and easy for Asian travelers to get to. From Bangkok, US$116 round trip on average, and 2 hours and 15 minutes. $219 and 4 hours and 44 minutes from Taipei, and $318 and 8 hours, a quick hop, relatively speaking, from Sydney. But back in the early 2000s, Singapore found itself losing to its many regional competitors. Its share of tourism in the Asia-Pacific region shrunk from 13.1% in 1991 to just 5.8% by 2004. This was attributed, in part, to its lack of natural physical attractions, a symptom of its small size. Today, Singapore has only one of the 1,121 total UNESCO World Heritage Sites, its botanical gardens, and, at the time, none. Neighboring Malaysia, meanwhile, has 4, Vietnam, 8, and Thailand, 5, all three of which are well-known, inexpensive destinations. To stay competitive and revive its national image, the Singapore government surprised everyone in 2004 when it floated the radical idea of legalizing casinos, 4 decades after making them illegal. Culturally, casino gambling was considered destructive and fundamentally at odds with the country's very conservative mentality and willingness to ban or regulate just about anything. Social and religious groups protested, a rare sight in authoritarian Singapore, and 30,000 people signed a petition in opposition. Kasi no bumper stickers could be seen on cars, and hundreds of polls, surveys, and dialogues were held. It soon became known that the city-state's then 4 million people were roughly evenly divided on the issue, and calls were made for a referendum, an indicator of how passionate the public had become. Then, in April of 2005, just 13 months later, it was all over. The government announced it would allow the construction of not one, but 2 casino resorts, one in the centrally located Marina Bay and the other on the southern island of Sentosa. For comparison, Sydney debated the merits of opening casinos for a full 6 years. But for the Singaporean government, this quick, effective, and sometimes contradictory decision-making is characteristic. In 1987, for example, its family planning slogan was changed from stop at 2 directly to have 3 or more if you can afford it. In any case, the government had made up its mind and began soliciting requests for concepts from interested bidders. Importantly, the government invented the now popular term integrated resort to describe a single development with an attached hotel, convention center, entertainment, theme parks, luxury retail shops, fine dining, and yes, a casino. This was its billion-dollar hint to bidders, although they were interested, first and foremost, in developing one of Singapore's first casinos. They were to be designed as iconic and symbolic national landmarks. Of the 19 submitted proposals, 14 were shortlisted and 4 continued with formal bids. Finally, in May 2006, the Las Vegas Sands Corporation was selected for Marina Bay, thanks to its proven success in Nevada and Macau. Also crucial was the architect, Israeli Moshe Safdie, who at age 27 had designed Montreal's famous Habitat 67. Safdie's impressive proposal for a three-tower block design was cleverly modeled after playing cards. Each of the three towers would be composed of two structures, one flat and one curved 10 times more than the Leaning Tower of Pisa. This unique concept breaks conventional rules of architecture in that higher floors actually become larger and larger until they reach the hotel's three most expensive and luxurious chairman suites. As if not ambitious enough, there was only a 27-month window for construction, which required a 4-day cycle, meaning an entire floor would need to be completed every 4 days to stay on track. The Singapore government argued that a hotel this grand deserved an equally impressive pool. It was decided that a 3-acre, 340-meter-long park would be built on top, complete with jogging paths, 4 swimming pools, an observation deck, promenade, restaurants, spa, and 900 species of plants. Called the Sky Park, it resembled a ship sailing above Singapore. Beautiful as it was, the park presented several significant challenges. First, how to get it up. Ultimately, the hull was constructed on the ground in 14 sections, then lifted into place at a slow, safe speed of 46 feet per hour, 16 hours to lift each segment all the way. Second, as infinity pools, the water needed to flow evenly to create the illusion of falling off the top. This, despite the fact that the 380,000-gallon pools also laid on top of 3 55-story towers, which would sink over time as their foundations shifted, each at a different rate and all susceptible to wind. To protect against this, 4 joints were placed beneath each pool, capable of moving up to 500 millimeters to offset any changes. Getting the pool from Indiana took more than 30 cargo ships, and the park alone was itself a $150 million project. When it soft opened in 2010, the Marina Bay Sands was neither the world's nor Singapore's tallest building. Rather, it turns heads for somehow being somewhat absurd, fantastic, and iconic all at the same time. It's one of those few buildings which retains its beauty no matter the angle, vantage point, or time of day. Inside the hotel, visitors are greeted with a stunning hollow atrium. The pools create the sensation of swimming on top of skyscrapers, while the other side of the Sky Park offers a view of the garden, an endless flow of container ships passing through the strait. The attached mall, with its indoor canal, is somehow just as impressive. Further south is Resorts World Sentosa. It features a more family-friendly environment with an aquarium, water park, Universal Studios, wax museum, hotel complex, and Singapore's other casino. Although less architecturally impressive, Resorts World Sentosa is remarkable for its sheer density of attractions. Unsurprisingly, both locations have been hugely successful. The Marina Bay Sands has quickly become the world's most profitable casino and been a huge source of growth for the Singapore economy. As of 2018, the tiny city-state receives more international visitors than New York, Dubai, or Paris, and only fewer than Macau, London, Bangkok, and Hong Kong. This was and is the best case for legalizing casinos, here or anywhere. Proponents argue it's easy money, that there's no faster way to create wealth out of thin air. Amazingly, Singapore's 2 resorts contribute between 1.5 and 2% of its entire GDP. They create an estimated 20,000 jobs directly, in the form of dealers, inspectors, hotel staff, entertainers, cashiers, slot attendants, and so on, and an additional 30 to 40,000 indirectly. Not only do they attract more tourists, but also higher quality, business travelers, and VIPs. On the other hand, some are skeptical of the economic benefits, suggesting increased tax revenue is offset by increased expenditures in the form of enforcement, infrastructure, and, not to be forgotten, the social costs of casinos. While the majority of Singaporeans admit to gambling themselves, in some form, most also believe casinos are unique in the way they encourage addiction. Their interiors are designed with the express intent of keeping players inside as long as possible, which for a small minority leads to pathological behavior. This tiny group of people then disproportionately cost their communities in the form of lost productivity, bankruptcy, crime, welfare, and, of course, the suffering of their families. Casinos, unlike races or cruises, are available 24/7. It's said that a casino within 10 miles of a person's home leads to a 90% increase in the odds of that person becoming a pathological gambler. One 2005 study also estimated such a person costs themselves and their community $19,711 on average a year. Casinos also target specific culturally vulnerable groups, for instance by adhering closely to feng shui principles to play on superstition. Still others accept a combination of these arguments. They argue that players will travel to wherever gambling is available. The only question is whether to capture their spending locally. In the US, for example, states are more likely to legalize casinos when their neighbors do first. In Singapore, gamblers have always had easy access in Malaysia, Indonesia, and on cruises. This was one of the primary rationales for Singapore's decision back in 2005. Why not benefit from what's already going to happen? But although it would do the unthinkable and open the door to casinos, it would do so in a uniquely Singaporean way. While every other gambling hub in the world flaunts its casinos for all they're worth, Singapore has been very careful to balance profit with the attendant social costs, arguably at great expense. From the very beginning, the National Development Commission stipulated the casino could not occupy more than 3-5% of the total resort space. The original plan for a strong Venetian theme and monorail connecting the casino to the ferry terminal were later replaced, at the insistence of the government, with the Sky Park and pool. The resort is also the company's only property where the location precedes the Sands brand in its name, a subtle reflection of the project's focus. The original architect, an expert in casino design, was later replaced with Softy, who is instead known for impressive and unique architecture. The two gaps between the building's three towers grant a view of the sea beyond it. It complements rather than intrudes on the skyline, in contrast to most casinos. In practice, this means the Marina Bay Sands is neither as tacky as Vegas or shady as Macau. It's an immediate, iconic symbol of Singapore. You might spend hours shopping, eating, swimming, even stay at the hotel, but aside from the occasional sign, you may not even notice the existence of the casino, where the company makes roughly 70% of its profit. For its part, the government has also taken tangible steps to reduce problematic behavior. Family members can request their loved ones be barred from gambling, those under 21 are forbidden from entering casinos, and ATMs are not available inside the gambling areas. Most significantly, Singapore residents are required to pay an entry fee of $150 or $3,000 per year to access each resort, neither of which are allowed to refund or reimburse that fee. Today, 10 years after their grand openings, most people would say Singapore has succeeded. It's reaped the economic benefits while at the same time managing the effects. Still, in hiding its casinos, it runs the risk of also hiding their damage, their casualties, their hardships. By taxing dubious behavior, Singapore not only deters it and profits from it, but also risks economically depending on it. After Singapore is sanitized, making itself clean, green, and its vices unseen, it's easy to forget what's lost. If casinos, economics, and the economics of casinos interest you, you're going to love my upcoming 30-minute documentary about a very related topic. I've been saying this for a while, but this time, I promise, it's written, recorded, and coming quite soon. In the meantime, you should listen to the also related story of how two mathematicians applied their genius to the game of blackjack, and then used their knowledge to win on Wall Street. This story, called Fortune's Formula, has just about everything that interests me: economics, business, finance, and a fascinating narrative. And you can listen to it, along with thousands of other audiobooks, with Audible. Audible is so easy for me to recommend because I religiously listen to so many audiobooks myself. You can listen to them in the shower, on the way to work or school, or while playing video games. You can download them for offline with their free mobile apps, and membership gives you access to any one audiobook a month, plus two Audible originals. Go to my link in the description, audible.com/polymatter, that's audible.com/polymatter, or text polymatter to 500-500 for a 30-day free trial. Thanks to Audible for sponsoring this video, and to you for watching.